What's going on, all my healthcare brothers and sisters? I hope that you are having a wonderful day. My goal with Nurse Chung is to help you pass your NCLEX as well as your nursing exams like a boss. And today, we're going to be discussing hypocalcemia. Let's get our electrolyte on. So in order to understand what happens with our electrolyte imbalances, we really have to understand what the electrolyte is. And we're going to start with calcium. So what is calcium? Well, normal range of calcium is between 9 to 10.5 milligrams per deciliter. And the main function of calcium is it really helps regulate three hormones found within our body. The first is our parathyroid hormone. So if we have an increase in parathyroid hormone, it will cause an increase in serum calcium levels and a decrease in phosphorus levels. So what you will learn as we move through this series is that calcium and phosphorus really have an inverse relationship. When one goes up, the other goes down, and vice versa. So also, when it comes to our calcium, they are best friends with magnesium. So when you have a high calcium level, you're probably going to have a high magnesium level and a low phosphorus level. So make sure you check out those other videos where we go more in depth of what these relationships look like. Another hormone that it regulates is calcitonin. And what calcitonin does is it puts calcium into our bones. We want that calcium in our bones. And then lastly, it regulates calcitrol, which ultimately controls blood calcium by stopping the release of calcitonin. A couple more main functions when it comes to calcium is it helps magnesium. So calcium will help with magnesium's main functions when magnesium is low. So when we have a low magnesium, calcium is going to step up for their best friend and help them with all of the functions that they would normally have. Remember, magnesium and calcium, best friends, and they're not really good friends with phosphorus. That's why they have that inverse relationship. And lastly, it helps keep the following team players strong. So it helps with bone mineralization. It keeps our bones hard. It helps with our beats. It aids in neuromuscular processes. So nerve impulses and muscle contraction is something that calcium also helps with. And then lastly, it helps with our blood coagulation. So remember, it helps with our team players, our three Bs, our bones, our beats, and our blood. So what is hypocalcemia? Well, hypo, low, calcemia, calcium in the blood. So we're going to have a low calcium range, less than 9 milligrams per deciliter. And there's quite a few causes that can cause hypocalcemia. We'll begin with the inhibition of calcium absorption from the gastrointestinal tract. So if we have inadequate oral intake of calcium, we're ultimately going to have hypocalcemia. Our lactose intolerant patients who are unable to intake any kind of milk byproducts or milk itself will ultimately have hypocalcemia. Malabsorption syndromes, such as celiac disease or Crohn's disease, can ultimately cause hypocalcemia. You can also have patients that are like chronic alcohol abusers as well as liver disease patients have an effect when it comes to our calcium. Inadequate intake of vitamin D or low magnesium levels. So vitamin D is required for the absorption of calcium in our gut. So if we don't have enough vitamin D, it doesn't matter how many times we take calcium supplements, it's not going to do anything. So we have to have vitamin D in order to help with that absorption of calcium in our gut. And then lastly, we have end-stage kidney diseases when it comes to the inhibition of calcium absorption in our GI tract. Our next category is increased calcium excretion. So we can see kidney disease again, polyuric phase. If we're peeing out a whole lot, that can also cause increased calcium excretion. Massive diarrhea, I'm talking about massive, massive diarrhea, can ultimately lead to calcium excretion. Statorrhea, where we've got a lot of fat within our stools, and wound drainage, especially GI drainage. Anytime we have any kind of NG tube drainage, you're going to see different electrolytes are going to be affected by that. So calcium is normally absorbed in the GI tract. If we're sucking all of that out, well, you know, we're going to have hypocalcemia. So another category of hypocalcemia is conditions that decrease the ionized fraction of calcium. So when we have hyperproteinemia, where we've got an increase of protein in our serum blood vessels, ultimately that increase of protein intake increases urinary excretion of calcium. So again, if we've got an increase in protein, then we're going to start excreting a lot of calcium. Alkalosis is another big one when it comes to that decrease in ionized fraction of calcium. Medications such as calcium chelators as well as binders is a big one. Acute pancreatitis. So I can't say this enough. Acute pancreatitis causes a lot of issues. So ultimately, the release of calcium soaps in the abdominal cavity, as well as a stimulated calcitonin hormone, is ultimately going to put calcium into the bones. More calcium is going to the bones, there's going to be less in our serum levels, causing hypocalcemia. You can also have hyperphosphatemia. So like we talked about before, that calcium and that phosphate are going to have increased relationships. So if our calcium is low, then our phosphorus is going to go up. Hypoparathyroidism is a decrease in parathyroid hormone that will decrease calcium levels. So we talked about before, one of the main functions of that parathyroid is to help with calcium. So if it's decreased, we're ultimately going to have a decrease in calcium. Immobility is a big one. If we have a patient that's not moving and they're not functioning appropriately, like they have bad ADLs and they're unable to do what we normally do as humans, then they can have a decrease in calcium serum levels. And lastly, removal or destruction of that parathyroid gland is ultimately going to affect how our calcium is distributed in the body. And lastly, our last category for hypocalcemia is medications that cause low calcium. So medications such as laxatives and loop diuretics are calcium wasting medications. Corticosteroids can suppress that parathyroid hormone and calcium release into the blood. Anti-seizure medications such as phenobarbital and Dilantin can actually increase the excretion of calcium in the kidneys. And lastly, we have citrate, which is found in a lot of your blood products and is ultimately metabolized by the liver. So if the liver is damaged, it will affect how these processes occur. And as we know, citrate binds to both calcium and magnesium. So if it's binding to these electrolytes and it's getting rid of these electrolytes, ultimately, we're going to start to see decreased serum electrolyte levels. So now that we understand some causes of hypocalcemia, what is our patient going to look like? What is the patient presentation? So when it comes to our cardiovascular system, we're going to have inefficient contractility of our muscles because we don't have enough calcium. So you're going to see decreased heart rates, hypotension, decreased peripheral pulses, they're usually very diminished, and a big risk for bleeding and dysrhythmias, such as ventricular tachycardia. One of the main functions we talked about with calcemia is our blood, so we're going to have that big increased risk of bleeding. Our respiratory system, it's not really directly affected, but the respiratory system can ultimately fail or going to arrest due to the decrease in respiratory movement because of the muscle tetany or seizures that occur because of the low calcium. When it comes to our neuromuscular system, we're going to have irritable skeletal muscles. So you're going to see those increase in twitching, cramps, tetany, and seizures are going to occur a lot with our hypocalcemic patients. They're going to have painful muscle spasms in their calf or their foot during periods of inactivity. So if they're just sitting on the couch or sitting in their bed, and all of a sudden they start to have these massive muscle spasms, there's probably something going on with their calcium levels. Paresthesias, followed by numbness that can affect the lips, nose, and ears can occur. They might have a positive, they will have a positive Trousseau's or Chavosky's sign. So our classic signs that you're going to see with Chavosky's is that when you stroke that facial muscle, their cheek is going to kind of twitch. So you're going to kind of stroke and they're going to... That's kind of what you're going to see when it comes to that particular sign. And with Trousseau's, the hand and the wrist are ultimately going to spasm when you inflate the blood pressure cuff on their arm. So you're going to see kind of a downward and sometimes like an outward turn when it comes to the Trousseau sign. Hyperactive deep tendon reflexes can occur, anxiety and irritability, and you can also see osteoporosis because the body is trying to get more calcium into the blood system. So where are they going to get that from? They're going to get it from the bones. So the more that they're pulling out from the bones, the weaker our bones are going to be, ultimately causing osteoporosis. So when it comes to our gastrointestinal system, they're going to be highly hyperactive. So you're going to see an increase in gastric motility as well as very hyperactive bowel sounds. Cramping and diarrhea can also occur with the loss of calcium. With the renal system, your urinary output is really going to vary dependent on what the cause of the hypocalcemia is. And lastly, with laboratory findings, the serum calcium level is going to be low. It's going to be less than that 9 milligrams per deciliter. And you're going to see electrocardiogram changes. So you're going to have prolonged ST intervals as well as prolonged QT intervals. So what are we going to do? What are we as nurses going to do to help this patient? Well, ultimately, if we have low calcium, we want to replace it, right? We're going to replace calcium either IV or PO by mouth. So when administering calcium IV, we really want to warm the injection fluid as much as possible to body temperature because it helps with the discomfort of receiving calcium IV. So really try to warm it up to body temperature as much as you can before administration. You really want to administer this slowly, like you do with any electrolyte, really, because if you rapidly correct too quickly, it can cause a heap of problems. We want to monitor for electrocardiogram changes as well as infiltration and hypercalcemia, because if we overcorrect too quickly, we can send them in the other direction, causing all of those issues. And lastly, if we're giving a PO, we really need to make sure that we have a vitamin D supplement, because ultimately vitamin D helps with calcium absorption. So we want to make sure that we have that on board when we're looking at our orders and we're replacing calcium. Also, medications that increase calcium absorption, such as aluminum hydroxide or TUMS, reduces phosphorus levels, causing the counter effect by increasing calcium levels. So again, when you're taking your NCLEX and your nursing exams, you're not going to see brand names. TUMS is not going to be on your exam. So you really have to learn what those generic names are. The aluminum hydroxide is ultimately TUMS, but you need to make sure that you know what that is, because again, you're not going to see that, especially not on the NCLEX. Vitamin D, again, you want to make sure that you have that because it aids in the absorption of calcium in the intestinal tract. You want to provide a quiet environment to reduce environmental mental stimuli, because ultimately calcium is just, it's constantly, it's causing a lot of hyperactivity. So if you're constantly being stimulated and you have all of the stimulus going on in your environment, it's going to be too much. So we really want to put them in a very quiet, relaxed environment to help them until we can correct the calcium deficit. We want to initiate seizure precautions. Again, it's highly important we initiate that. We want to move the patient very carefully because they are at an increased risk of fractures as well as bleeding. So if we move them too quickly, we can ultimately cause some kind of internal bleeding as well as a fracture, because with all of the hypocalcemia that's occurring in the serum levels of our blood, they're going to be what? They're going to be pulling from our bones. So if we're pulling constantly from our bones to try to help correct all of that hypocalcemia, we're going to have osteoporosis in our bones, leading to an increased risk of fractures. And then lastly, we want to educate the patient on consuming calcium-rich foods, such as dairy. We have cheese, milk, and yogurt are big options. They can also eat collard greens as well as broccoli. And then lastly, tofu and sardines also have a good amount of calcium to help with that hypocalcemia. I hope that this video was helpful for you in passing your nursing exams like a boss. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them down below. I love answering your questions. Make sure that you follow me on my social media. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, as well as here on YouTube. Make sure that you subscribe as well as like this video. I also have a website at www.nursechung.com where I will have NCLEX style questions as well as additional resources with each of my videos. So make sure that you check that out. But until next time, I hope that you're having a wonderful day, and I will speak with you all again soon. Bye.